Well, yeah. Would you stop working shoulders?
Yeah.
So, hey, first of all, happy 4th of July.
Yep.
I'm wearing, obviously, the Masked Man Mark gimmick.
Yeah, I don't have one, so.
No, you're just, well, you're
Vader. I have one gimmick, that's it.
That's it. I have a whole bunch of
I'm wearing a different shirt, though, today.
Yeah, that's a cool shirt. I actually thought that's it was okay. Stone Cold. Hey, yeah. Listen, speaking of guys in hoods.
Yeah.
Oh. We had, oh boy, we had a classic on today. We're talking PWI 500 guy. We're talking YouTube sensation.
Yeah.
We're talking cult, pop culture, like, icon.
Yeah.
Brother Midnight.
Baby.
Yeah, baby. And let me tell you, this guy, his name is Stan Saxon.
Yeah.
He's wrestled from in the 90s. He's trained guys. He's worked with guys like Jericho, Lance Storm. And of course, Brother Midnight was on our show, and it was,
and that was awesome.
Like, think about how many times in any lifetime you get to interview an icon.
Yeah.
Like, other than you.
Yeah.
Right.
Well,
you are the icon.
You had Bret Hart. You talked to him.
So. Hart Schmart.
You've had a few guys over.
Yeah,
there.
One or two guys, but Brother Midnight, like, to get
that was
this
a lot
guy
of fun, so.
and get the
we gotta get him back.
We're definitely gonna have him back.
Yeah.
So listen. The guy went through hell and back with an injury. He's going to talk about that.
Yep.
We're going to talk a little bit of mental health. And you got to stick around to the end because the promo he cuts as Brother Midnight is second to none.
Yeah.
So, listen, guys, thanks for supporting. Make sure you click down below and subscribe to the show. If you're looking for this character on the Twitter, it's at...
The Twitter.
The Twitter. It's at Vader from Wish.
Yep.
And I'm at NWO...
_
Machine. Enjoy the show.
Do you have a face for a dark room? Do people tell you you're ugly? Have you ever looked in the mirror and it cracked? Have you ever been to the zoo and people throw peanuts and food at you? Well, let me tell you what. Why don't you check out Mark's Wrestling Masks on Facebook. That's MARC*S. Mark's Wrestling Masks on Facebook, because that's who keeps our ugly mugs covered too. Welcome to the Shiz Show with your hosts, Vader from Wish and NWO Machine. And NWO Keth.
Man, that smells good. I can't get rich, I can't make a living, but I sure do something for the neighborhood women. I wake up every morning with them knocking at my door. You can't keep them waiting when they're begging for more. Back, back, I holler to my hound. You're supposed to keep them from coming around. I used to think they were after me, but they're just after my recipe for good brown gravy.
Welcome to the Shiz Show. Hi, Vader.
Hey, how's it going, Machine?
I'm doing good. Now, that's a cool...
I love that song. Now,
okay, so let's not say whose song that is, but what's the name of that song?
It's Good Brown Gravy by Joe Diffie.
Good Brown Gravy. Okay, we
got it. It's got a Southern Revival type of
and there's a specific reason for that said song, and we are going to get into that. But before then, I just want to mention to all our U.S. listeners, a happy 4th of July.
Yeah, happy.
Yeah,
happy Treason Day.
Yeah. Yeah, I'm sure that turncoat Danny Duggan has had a good celebration.
I'm sure he did
on the CWE run. So we're going to get right to the meat and potatoes here with the brown gravies or brown gravies.
Good brown gravy.
Good brown gravy.
Any kind of it's going to be good stuff.
We have a guest who literally is like, for lack of a better term, he is like a pop culture icon in the independent wrestling scene, but he's known to me and you as our buddy Stan Saxon.
So Brother Midnight.
Brother Midnight, welcome to the show.
Well, thanks, guys. It's a pleasure to be here.
He's lying already.
We're cutting off the guests. That's why no one wants to come on.
I know.
So, yeah, I really enjoy your show, and I'm glad to be here. Let's talk wrestling.
Let's talk some wrestling. So 89-90 was your debut, and you started out as, obviously, Stan Saxon.
That's right.
Okay, so let's...
In 80, Okay, you know what? You tell me when to talk, boss. Well, no.
That's enough. We're going to hang up now. That was Stan. He was a great guest. Well, I just want to know, so we always ask everybody who comes on, what got you into this business? Like, what made you go, you know what? This is what I want to do.
Well, I was into wrestling, as a lot of us were when we were young. I used to watch the AWA on CKND Channel 12 here in Winnipeg. And I could tell pretty quickly that it was, I didn't know the terminology, but I could tell it was a work.
Yeah.
You know, drop kicks, missing, punches, not even close. But people are selling. And I used to go to the matches with my brother and my dad at the old Winnipeg Arena. And the place would be crazy with emotion. And I was feeling that emotion myself. And I wonder why. Well, why does this happen? Why, when most reasonable people can tell it's some kind of work, how are they generating this emotion? And I continued my obsession. Well, it was a mild obsession and grew into a pretty strong one. And until the WWF started getting big and following that. And I figured, you know what? I got to experience this from the inside.
Yeah.
And that's really what motivated me to get into it. It was never about, oh, I want to be a big star. I want to be cool to my friends. I wanted to experience this in how to generate emotion from people from something that is likely not 100% legit.
Yep.
It was either that or government.
Yeah, pretty much.
So now let's fast forward. So you get involved. Who trained you?
I trained with Eddie Watts primarily. There was a group here in Manitoba. Watts was my primary trainer. Rick Patterson sat in with a few of my training sessions as Leatherface out in Japan, and a few other not as well-known guys, but Eddie was pretty much my chief trainer, and I pretty much owe a lot of my involvement to him.
So, Sax, here's a question, and we asked the Kevin Cannon last week that what he's taken forward basically into his life settings, or if you're talking to guys today, what piece of valuable advice did you get when you trained that you could pass on to someone today?
Well, what I would say, I'm not sure is relevant to today's wrestling, because I've recently found that today's wrestling is so different than it was. Okay, well, to answer your question, I would say this. Take it seriously. This is a business. Conduct yourself as a professional and understand you will get hurt. It's not a matter of if, it's a matter of when and how bad.
Yeah.
Now, what I was going to say about the change in the business is, and I want to point out, I'm not bashing today's business. I'm coming through a period where I used to bash today's business because it's not the same as it was in the 80s and the 90s.
Yeah.
And I was becoming one of those crotchety old men in my day.
Yeah.
And I really wanted to understand the new business, but it's not it's not a presentation where you are trying to convince people that you're scary as a heel, for example.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
But any professional in any professional activity needs to conduct themselves with professionalism, obviously.
Yeah. I just want to mention one thing. Like, when I ask, you know, like our guests these things, like Stan Saxon, when I'm at an indie show, right?
Yeah.
And Saxon walks in. It's like the Pope just walked in.
Oh, yeah.
Like, everyone kisses the ring when Saxon walks in.
Well, he's got the respect of all the boys in the back.
Like, we are talking to a guy today who is, like, PWI 500 tops.
Yeah.
Right? Like, this is, it doesn't happen often that happens in life. So, here's a guy who took everything seriously, like he just said.
Yeah.
It's going to happen. Things can happen. You're going to get hurt, but take it seriously. Treat yourself like a business and be respectful. And this guy has all the respect when he walks in a room.
And he was great as a new wrestler coming up. I remember one of my first matches at Chalmers, and I was wrestling. I'm pretty sure that you were Brother Midnight at the time. And I called for like a stinger splash, and then we went into the finish. And then after the match, we go back, and you're holding your ribs, and you're looking at me, and you're like, well, when you say you can do a stinger splash, I tend to believe that you know how to do it without hurting somebody. And you made me feel like absolute crap until I realized after that it was a rib. And I kind of felt a little bit like, hey, I'm accepted now by the boys. So, and that was awesome. You know, I don't know if the guys still do that, but
I remember that night that feels like it was in Portage. No, that was Chalmers.
It was Chalmers, right? Yeah.
Yeah, I put the same rib on Horse in Portage. That's what I'm thinking of.
I never heard that he got that one. So I was like, what the hell? I thought it was good. But she had me second guessing myself, but then I realized it was a rib and it was awesome. It was a lot of fun, too.
Yeah, yeah. Well, and see, that's the whole key, right? Being accepted in the end and having a guy like Sax come in and give you that prop, right? Like, that's pretty cool to get that rub, too. So now let's fast forward, since you brought this up, that you will, you know, take it seriously, you will get hurt. You had well, we're going to go into a little bit of mental health because we like to push that too. So you had a crazy injury, which sent you in a bit of a spiral, which spawned off your greatest character. So let's get into that story.
All right. Well, this was, I believe it was 92. I was booked out to do the Maritimes for Emile. No, this wasn't Emile. It was Stephen Pettipaw. He worked as Sheik Ali in the Montreal. Remember the international wrestling out of Montreal?
Yeah.
But Pettipaw was running the Maritimes, and they brought me in, and they put the belt on me, which was... It was strange to me because I was a 21-year-old kid, but they had Patterson booked as the champion, and Patterson got himself booked for a better deal in Mexico. So Eddie Watts was second. He was deputy booker out there. Leo Burke was the booker. And Eddie called me and says, hey, kid, get out to the Maritimes. We're going to put the belt on you. So I hop on a plane and got to the Maritimes. They tell me, okay, I'm the Texas Outlaw Rick Patterson. What? Okay, he's 2 inches taller than me, and he's about 50 pounds heavier than me. And Eddie says, don't worry, after a couple of weeks, we'll drop the Rick Patterson. You'll just be the Texas Outlaw, and then whatever. So I got into like a 6-week program with Leo Burke. And this guy, if you know Leo, he's the Hulk Hogan of the Maritimes.
Okay.
And he was so well respected and a tremendous worker. He eventually became one of the trainers for WCW. A lot of his trainees have gone on to get that Bugs Bunny money at WCW, and they figured, well, we got to get Leo some of this TBS money because he brought us here. So anyway, what happened was I was working this program with Leo, and it was going so well. It was going so well. The crowds were super hot every single night. And I just got stupid. I just got stupid. And I was high on the hot crowd. And I started doing stuff that I shouldn't be doing. I'm not qualified. So I did I did a Randy Macho Man Savage go to the top rope, come down with a double axe handle on the floor.
Yeah.
And this was midsummer in the Maritimes in a hockey arena.
Oh, I feel the heat already.
Yeah, the sweat on the floor.
Sweat on the floor. And when I hit, and I jumped a distance too. At least Savage kind of went straight down.
Yeah.
But I went a distance, and I shouldn't have, obviously, and destroyed it. I destroyed my leg. It buckled left. I felt a zipper, like a zipper inside my knee buckling left, and then another zipper buckling right. And I had to be carried out. We finished. We did a finish. I'm not sure it was exactly the finish. But Leo put me in a sleeper, and then Cuban Assassin and a few of the other heels hit the ring, but they all had to carry me back. So then I came back here to Manitoba, and I fought with the healthcare system for almost 2 years before I finally got in for surgery, and I was a mess. Mm-hmm. I was a mess mentally. I was putting on weight. I was up around 285 by the time I got to the gurney.
Yeah.
And I was a freaking mess. And I finally got surgery, and then, okay, now this is going to be another rehab. Mm-hmm. And I'd gone through like a physical rehab before I even had my surgery. And that's another story why they put me through that. But short answer is, I was a mental mess. I was on the verge of doing something really, really, really bad. And I thought, you know what? The only thing that ever made me happy is wrestling. I can't wrestle, but what if I learned to talk? And what if I learned to not take this so seriously and have a little fun?
Yeah.
So I started learning to talk. I started watching the best promos in the business. I started watching other public speakers. I started learning. I was watching televangelists, everything. And that... So when I did the first Brother Midnight promo ever, it was actually the first Brother Midnight promo, which I don't know any video exists anywhere. It was actually Captain Midnight. It was just a throw together generic hooded guy. But when I did the promo, and it had the aura of a televangelist or something similar, someone gave me the name Brother Midnight. And then it started to get a following. And they put me in a team with a guy named Sweet Daddy Cadillac, and he had a similar gimmick, you might say.
Yeah.
And we started getting a following in terms of we were getting letters. And this was 95, roughly. Yeah. So there was no email or anything.
Oh.
And so then the boss told us, okay, you guys, we're pushing you to the top, you and Caddy, Midnight and Caddy. And then we thought, well, how, like, we're a brand new team. We've got no record or anything. So that turned into our favorite angle of all time.
And so now here's my question to you. Like, tell me, so you did this, like, here you are. You know, Stan Saxon, you're doing everything in the Maritimes. You're taking it pretty serious, and you're not thinking anything except, you know what, I'm just going to go have fun this time with a hood, and you become this popular. Like, that must have given you, like, okay, what the hell just happened here, right? Because even to this day, Brother Midnight is massively popular on YouTube.
Yeah.
How it happened is not quite clear, but I think the notion of just having fun with it and inviting the fans to have fun along with it may have played a role. Because when it was midsummer, we were doing promos at the local TV studio there, and it was midsummer, and both of Midnight and Caddy, we wore suit jackets as our as our rain jackets.
Yeah.
And we show up at the studio wearing shorts, and so so Caddy hears me talking to the cameraman, you know, make sure that you only shoot us from waist up, because we got shorts off, you know, pretty obvious. And then Caddy approaches me and says, hey, the boss wants to push us, but we're brand new and we're a comedy team. Why don't we shoot an angle here on TV that we're just going to show up and not wear pants until we get the title shot? And as stupid an angle as that was, it started to get over, especially it started as The Office was, well, no, this is professional wrestling. We are taking this seriously. You must put pants on.
If I had a nickel.
The people got behind it when Caddy and Midnight would come out to ringside prancing around in our boxer shorts. Persuading The Office, give us our title shot, give us our title shot. And then they finally caved.
Yeah.
And by the time we got our title shot, and we took the titles, we had 400 people in there.
Mm-hmm.
Where when we started this angle, there was maybe 50 people.
Yeah.
So going by percentage, that's quite an increase.
Yeah.
And everyone was quite proud of that. And it was a whole lot of fun.
Yeah.
Do you still have the hood?
The Midnight hood,
yeah.
the original blue one with the webbed eyes, I don't know where it went.
No.
It turned into like a generic hood for anybody here in Manitoba. I don't know. I loaned it to someone because they needed it, and then it got passed around, and I don't know where it is now.
No,
we'll have to do our own Manitoba's treasures, like with
WWE treasures.
We got to find that hood.
we definitely have to find that for sure. And if not, I think I know someone who could make one for you.
Yeah.
Our show sponsor, Masked Man Mark, for sure would definitely get into something like that. I'm sure if you needed a new Brother Midnight hood.
Yeah.
Yeah. Right on.
So let's talk your. I don't think it was Brother Midnight had this angle, but. You did a program with Jericho and, hang on now.
Would have been Lance Storm?
Lance Storm, I think. Yeah.
Yeah, that was early 92 for Tony Candelo. And he brought a crew in from Alberta and BC. There were some BC guys also. But Jericho and Storm came through. And I worked maybe a dozen matches with Jericho and or Storm. Some of them were tags. I tagged with Don Callis and against Jericho and Storm, and we had some really good matches. And I had some good matches with the Jericho singles also. My memory of Chris Jericho was he was always nice guy,
mm-hmm.
but you could tell by the way he carried himself that he wasn't going to stay at this level for very long. Mm-hmm. He had that aura of, yeah, I don't belong here. I'm a nice guy, but I don't belong here. And it wasn't very long after that that he went down to Tennessee for Jim Cornette and Smoky Mountain Wrestling. He and Storm both went. And from there, well, we know what happened to Jericho.
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah, he kind of did crappy for himself because he's in AEW.
Yeah, that's a product I have to say I don't know anything about except for what Jim Cornette says on his podcast. So that's really my only connection to today's wrestling.
Yeah.
Is because I got to tell you, after I think it was 2010, I just, you know, this is totally different from what I know. But I've been trying to learn, you know, the new business and how it is. And there's a local group here. I met the group at the current CWE roster, and actually they're pretty decent. Like they're good guys. They're respectful to the old business, and it seems like they appreciate my change of attitude on the new business, from rather bashing the new business to trying to learn it and understand that it's different. Mm-hmm. So let's respect it on both ends.
Yeah. And they run they got a good locker room there in CWE. It's a lot different than I remember when I first started out. Like it's got a different feel to it, and it seemed a lot more welcoming overall. And like the Danny runs a good group there, and like you're saying, they're great guys and put on a good show.
Yeah, that's the feeling I got, was like this is a welcoming group, and when I show interest in learning how they do it now, mm-hmm. as opposed to the way it was in the 90s, it's not a matter of, well, this, you know, the old man telling you this is the way you're supposed to do it.
Well,
it's kind of different now. It's different.
Yeah.
And it's subtly different, mm-hmm. except that it pretty much we don't worry about kayfabe or anything.
Yeah.
So I have a question that I'm going to throw at you that this is going to come out of left field.
Oh,
and
boy.
It's one of those 3 degrees of separation that you did some training of young guys back in early 90s, I guess. Or even, I would say 2000, 99,
2000. I think it was around 96, 97-ish.
Okay. So you trained, here's where you and I have a silly connection somehow. And I mean, you and I have met like long before I even had a specific connection to the wrestler I'm going to bring up, because we did stuff with Callis and NHB and things like that. And I was in when I did the ring announcing. And but you trained a fellow that I ended up managing in Chris Paris.
Oh, right. Yeah, I remember him.
So, it was kind of interesting because I knew that connection, but I don't think I'd ever, even when I see you at events, we usually don't really talk a lot of shop. We say, hey, how's it going? We watch the show. We have a few laughs. But so you train a guy like Chris, whether you thought he had potential to do anything or not, I don't know. But how does it feel? And this is where I'm going to throw this. So you train Chris Paris. He ends up being managed by me. And the next thing you know, Chris Paris is in a match with a guy like Buff Bagwell. So how does that make you feel as like looking back on, you know what, man, has he come a long way? Because I'm assuming as a local guy who, you know, probably doesn't think you're going to get a chance with a Buff Bagwell or the LOD or whoever.
Yeah.
And there's other guys in the room that maybe could have it, and the booker decides, no, we're going to give this one to Paris. How does that make you feel looking back and going, hey, good job, kid? Or does that make you feel good for him?
Well, I guess it shows that my training was good enough, right? Yeah. So in that regard, it shows that he got trained good enough, because there are people that don't get very well trained, right?
Yeah.
So I mean, that's good for him. When I was training guys, I never really thought that far ahead. My whole deal in training guys was I want them to be professional workers. I want them to be safe, and I want them to do stuff that looks good, but it's got to be safe first.
Yeah.
If you can't do it safely, don't do it. Like Rob with his stinger splash. Right? Like Miss Jean and his, no, the Vader and Vader's stinger splash.
Yeah. No good Vader and his stinger splash.
I'm going to give you a chop when we're done with this.
So. Oh, thanks, Saxon. I'm going to take the beating for you. So you, I just want to go back to something that, like, a lot of people might be going, well, okay, what happened? You got up to the 300-pound mark, and it's, I mean, people don't realize, like, we do see each other outside of the ring, and recently, most recently, I saw Saxon, and he's pretty ripped up, man. Mm-hmm. I saw him at the gym. So you, how did you turn that around to, like, you're looking fantastic, man?
Well, I appreciate that. Well, it came down to learning about the body and learning about the brain and how they're connected. And poisonous food is obviously poisonous to the brain, and that can contribute to mental health problems. And I've been fighting mental health problems since I blew my knee in 92.
Yeah.
And what are we now? 2023. So that's 25 years. That's half of my life.
Yeah.
So eating clean and getting off the beer. I'm 10 and a half months sober now.
Oh, good for
and
you.
And I think it's going to be permanent this time.
Yeah.
And
one day at a time, buddy. One day at a time. That's the whole key. Yeah. You're doing good.
I think you're right. I think you're right. But the power of exercise in terms of mental health, learning about all of that, when I was on the road as a wrestler, you don't care that much because you're on the road, you're getting exercise, but after the show is done, there's the beer store.
Yeah.
Right? And then when you get hurt and now you can't do it and you realize, oh, my health is no good. I thought it was okay. I thought it was good, but no, it's not because I'm slowing down now.
Yeah.
And it's easy to sit around and drink beer.
Yep.
And that makes you feel better in the very, very short term. Mm-hmm. But overall, it makes it worse until you got serious problems.
Yep, for sure, buddy. Well, listen, Saxon, it's been a slice here, buddy. We, you know, we hit this 30-minute mark in a heartbeat.
Yeah.
I'll just say you're welcome anytime to come back. If you ever want to come and just chat mental health and tell us how you're doing and 11 months and 12 months and so on, you're always more than welcome to come on with any road stories or anything you want to chat about again. Next time, we usually do a random rumble.
Yeah.
Where we talk about a couple of wrestlers and we put two together and have a fantasy match, and we'd love to hear your opinions.
I forgot to put batteries in the randomizer.
Yeah, so
I needed them for the remote.
Yeah. So maybe we can have you back to talk about some wrestling other than our own shenanigans.
Yeah, that sounds great. I'd love to play the randomizer. I've heard it, and I think it's great.
Yeah, well, you know what? We'll book it for, I tell you what, in the next 2 weeks, we'll have you back. And we'll do the random rumble with
you.
Why
don't we do a 35-minute show and we can do it now?
Because I have somewhere to be tonight.
Oh, my God. Like, what?
I've been running around all day here where Mr. is sitting at home in his gitch making ribs.
I've been making ribs.
It just says sitting in your gitch making ribs.
And they look fantastic. And you're not getting any now.
I wasn't talking about the ribs. So, Saxon, let me put a little pressure on you. It's Welcome to the Shiz Show. Can you give us a little Brother Midnight on the way out?
Yeah, I think so. All right, everybody, this is Brother Midnight talking at you right here on the Shiz Show with Mr. Vader, baby, and Mr. Machine, if you understand me.
That was awesome. I just went back in time.
Oh, that is so cool. Stan Saxon, you are the best, and I am so happy that you didn't do the what you talked about where your head was in the wrong space, because I definitely wouldn't have met you and had a good friend. So thanks for coming on.
Thank you so much.
Yeah, and until next time, buddy, you keep kicking out, and we'll see you in a couple weeks. You can sob it with a biscuit, you can eat it from a pan, you can lick it off your fingers when it's running down your hand. If I could get a backer, I could cause a big commotion, I could put it on the market, call it biscuit.